We've got some funny ideas when it comes to Benjamin Franklin.
A penny saved is a penny earned.
The Franklin we know best was wise, inventive, and old. But what about Ben Franklin, the teenager?
He seems to have been about 5'10" or 5'11" tall, which means that he was probably about 4 or 5 inches taller than the average at the time. And he was strong. We know he was a very keen swimmer. There are some references to the fact that he had boxed when he was a young man.
Sure, he would go on to invent things like bifocals and swim fins and shock the world with his discoveries about electricity. But Ben Franklin was also impressive as a young man.
Was he a likable person?
He had enormous presence. I think when Franklin came into the room, he was the kind of person everybody would notice. I don't think he would necessarily try to dominate the room, but you couldn't miss him. And as soon as you started to hear him talk about the things he knew about, which was a great deal, you would soon see just what a powerful intellect he had.
You see, the smart tube reaches the bottom.
Now we can all learn something about the man we think we know, thanks to a new book about the young man we hardly know, young Benjamin Franklin, The Birth of Ingenuity.
Do you think he had an exceptional mind and exceptional intellect, or was he just somebody who just really applied himself?
Oh, he was definitely exceptional. In fact, he becomes more exceptional the more you study him.
Ben Franklin as a child and a father before he became a founding father. In this first person one-on-one with Nick Bunker, presented by St. Louis County Library and HEC Media.
Let's get this party started with Benjamin Franklin.
We are in the library of Chaminade, where there are any number of books about history, and of course, most of those books about American history all mention Benjamin Franklin, but the old Benjamin Franklin. We know very little, it seems, about young Benjamin Franklin, but we know a lot more now than we used to, thanks to Nick Bunker, who's with us today, who has written Young Benjamin Franklin. There are so many books out there that talk about Benjamin Franklin, and we all think we sort of know him. Why another book on Benjamin Franklin?
Well, I would only have embarked upon this project if I thought there was something new to add. With my previous books, I've taken the same approach, my previous books being about the early settlement of New England and also about the onset of the American Revolutionary War. And in this case, I felt that it was likely that there would be additional material that I could add over and above what Franklin said in his autobiography if I cast my net widely and examined documentary sources on archival sources on both sides of the Atlantic and also looked at some aspects of Franklin's early life that I think have been neglected.
What made you think that he would be interesting as a young person?
Well, it flowed out of my previous book, Empire on the Edge. In that book, I was dealing with the period in the 1770s when Franklin was, if you like, falling out of love with the British, that period when he was becoming estranged from them, in the period before and just after the Boston Tea Party. And I became fascinated by Franklin at that time. I was bitten by the Franklin bug, shall we say, because in that period, I was following the way that his attitude towards the British was unfolding over a period of months as he gradually became more and more unhappy with them. And I thought it'd be interesting to just start at the other end during the period in particular in his period in London in the mid-1720s, when actually he was in a sense falling in love with London and with Great Britain. So if you like, I was trying to complete the work that I'd begun in the previous book.
How critical to the formation of the Benjamin Franklin that we know were those years that he spent in London? Because he was there for quite a while at a very formative time in his life.
Well, he was there 18 months. He arrived at the back end of 1724 and he left again in the middle of 1726. Now, Franklin had a habit of being in the right place at the right time. It wasn't just a matter of luck. I think it was also because he had very wide interests. He prepared himself very well for things by wide reading and so on. And so that when he was presented with an opportunity, he took it. But there was a very interesting period to be there in the mid-1720s because there was the political conflicts going on in London. It was still the heyday of Sir Isaac Newton, the great scientist. Newton died in 1727. By then he's a very old man, he's 85, but it was still his heyday. He was still the great influential grand old man of British science. And Franklin was actually able to meet people who were collaborators and friends of the great Sir Isaac Newton. And he was also able to sample the literary life of London, which again was in full swing. Some of the greatest writers of the 18th century, Alexander Pope, Jonathan Swift, John Gay, were active. And Franklin again was kind of come into contact with that kind of very sophisticated literary world. And so during his period in London at that time, Franklin was able to acquire a direct first-hand experience of metropolitan culture in England in a way that very few Americans at the time would have been capable of doing.
And yet he fell out of love with England.
Eventually, yeah, but a long time later. I mean, much later, 50 years later. His fascination, his love of London, he lasted a very, very long time. The Franklin family, as I discovered, had always actually had connections with London, even before Franklin was born. And so London was always something that really figured very much in their lives and in his.
You think that the popular success of Hamilton on Broadway will bring you some readers who might not have otherwise thought that something about one of the people of that era would be interesting, would find it interesting?
Well, I would like to think that's true, but I think you'll find there's an awful lot of authors who are writing books about this particular period on the basis of us hoping that the success of Hamilton the musical will rub off on them. I think that's unlikely, actually, but I would like to think so. I mean, it would be nice to think that someone could turn Franklin into a musical, but unfortunately I think it's already been done. I think it was done many years ago.
1776.
Several attempts. And various attempts, Leonard Bernstein, I think, at one stage was trying to produce a musical about Franklin many, many years ago. So I'm not sure it would actually work. And also, I think Hamilton is the sort of character you can imagine bursting into song. I'm not sure you can imagine Franklin doing it, although I know he does in the musical.
For us I see immortality in Philadelphia City.
We think of him, as you aptly put it at the beginning of the book, as just this old man with I think this expression was the hair like seaweed on a rock, right, which I thought was fantastic. That's how we think of him, but in his youth, I suppose, as many of us were, it was completely different than the image we have of him as an old man. He was athletic, if nothing else. Talk about what he was like as a young man.
Well, you're right. And his physicality, I think, is really important. I mean, as far as we know, he seems to have been about 5'10" or 5'11" tall, which means that he was probably about 4 or 5 inches taller than the average at the time. And he was strong. We know he was a very keen swimmer. There are some references to the fact that he had boxed when he was a young man. And of course, he worked as a printer. And printing was an occupation that actually demanded physical strength, because you had to tote around these frames full of lead. And you had to work very hard for long hours with repetitive pulling of levers and so forth. So he was a strong, physically able sort of person. And I think that was important to him. He was a very confident man. I mean, that's something that I think is very important to recognize about Franklin, that he had a lot of self-confidence. And I think his physical strength and his athleticism actually played a part in that.
Did he also, though, have some self-doubts about his, particularly his youth, that he would write about later on in his own autobiography?
Oh, yes. I mean, one of the great themes of the autobiography is precisely the fact that he points to a number of errors and mistakes that he made. And he gives us a list. There are a good 6 or 7 or 8 mistakes in his early life that he alludes to. There are also clearly other things that he doesn't allude to that clearly happened. I mean, you can tell that he's passing over some incidents that even he was too ashamed to mention. The reason I say that is because we know that he kept on presenting for himself these plans of conduct. You know, as a young man, he was continually drawing up these codes and prescriptions for himself of ways to make himself better in a sort of religious, almost a religious fashion. And what that suggests is that there was quite a lot going on there, even over and above the faults he actually admits to. I think he was eventually, I think Franklin became a very integrated, kind of harmonious individual. But I think that was only after quite a prolonged kind of tussle with his own emotions.
You mentioned that he was a printer, which was a very important part of his life. He was also a journalist, and those two things seemed to go hand in hand in several instances of people, others in the book. Was that a general practice, that if you were the printer, you were also the publisher, the writer, so forth?
It certainly was in America. In London, printers doubled as booksellers and as publishers, and sometimes they also wrote themselves. So in London, there was a bit more of a clear division between the printer and the journalist. But in America, it's kind of common practice, frankly. I mean, Franklin would have had to do a great deal of work himself. It's actually hard to know, when you look at the newspaper he edited in Philadelphia, the Pennsylvania Gazette, how much was written by Franklin and how much was written by kind of team of collaborators. That's something that's a real problem for scholars, because, of course, at the time, journalism was all anonymous. There were no bylines. Bylines didn't really come in until the 20th century, and so we don't know. But certainly Franklin certainly must have written a large chunk of the Pennsylvania Gazette, and that required a lot of versatility and a lot of imagination.
Well, speaking of imagination, I mean, the pseudonyms he wrote under several. I'm talking about fake news.
Absolutely. Well, the most famous, Silence Do Good, which is the the young lady from Boston, whom he masqueraded as being when he was working for his brother James Franklin on the New England Courant. This is the early 1720s. Although actually the only reason we know that Franklin was silenced too good is because by chance a file of copies of the New England Courant survived, and it's now in the British Library in London, which was Franklin's copy, and on which he actually marked in the margin which articles he had written. Now, if Franklin hadn't done that, and that copy hadn't survived, we wouldn't actually know he was silenced Duguid, because no scholar actually identified him as silenced Duguid until about 1868.
Who would you say were some of his greatest influences? We talked a little bit about Sir Isaac Newton, but even in his own family, there were certain individuals that were particularly important in his in the formation of his life.
Oh, yeah. I mean, well, his father, Josiah, was a great influence, and also his uncle, Benjamin. Now, Franklin had an uncle, Benjamin, who was born in the 1650s in England and was a dyer of silk. This was one of the occupations of the Franklins in England. They were blacksmiths, they were also land surveyors, and they were dyers of silk in London. And Uncle Benjamin was a dyer of silk and also a very keen Presbyterian.
You mentioned religion. One of the things that you could almost say is a theme of the book is the wrestling match that he had through much of his life, but particularly his youth, with trying to decide how he felt about religion, what religion appealed to him. Talk about that, because that's a significant factor.
In his teens, Franklin gradually became something very close to an atheist. In fact, I think when he was in London in the mid-1720s, he was in effect an atheist. And he gradually retreated from that and became, developed a kind of a creed of his own, which was sort of a combination of poetry, Newtonian science, and a bit of politics thrown in as well. And he developed this kind of creed of his own, which was sort of a pragmatic kind of belief in a supreme being. It wasn't really an Orthodox Christian, but it was something that Franklin eventually turned into a kind of a workable kind of compromise with Christianity, which he stuck to pretty much, I think, the rest of his life. But he didn't really get there until he was about in his 30s, I would say.
Franklin predates IQ tests, but I'm wondering, do you think he had an exceptional mind, an exceptional intellect, or was he just somebody who just really applied himself?
Oh, he was definitely exceptional. In fact, he becomes more exceptional the more you study him. For example, he gives these accounts in his autobiography about some of the books he read when he was in his teens. It's not always clear exactly which books they were, so you have to ferret about a bit, as I did in the archives and in libraries, to try and determine exactly what that he was reading. And when you see what he was reading, when you identify those sorts of books, you can see they were very sophisticated indeed. For someone at 15 or 16 to be able to work his way through these books and fully understand the arguments, and then when he was in London and he was 18 or 19, actually to produce a philosophical work of his own, which he actually printed and had published, and doing this all long before he was 20, that's pretty remarkable. And there's no question he had a very, very powerful mind indeed. Obviously a very good player of chess as well, a very good writer. I mean, polymath. He did never really had the kind of mathematical training he should have had. And I think that's simply because it just wasn't available in America at the time. If I think he'd had the mathematical training that he would have got, let's say if he was in England or at Oxford or Cambridge or wherever, particularly Cambridge University, which he might have gone to if he was English, I think then you see would have seen him go even further. I think you would have seen quite remarkable discoveries. His discoveries are remarkable anyway, but I think they would have been even more astounding if he'd had that mathematical training.
The term that people seem to use today is a disruptor. I'm wondering, does that apply to Franklin?
Yeah, I think he was more of a builder, though, you see. I think when people ask me what I think was Franklin's greatest achievement, and I say, well, of course he was a great diplomat, played a huge role in the American war effort during the Revolutionary War, and of course he played a great role in the development of the Constitution and so on. But frankly, I see his greatest contribution really has been the building of a scientific infrastructure in America. I think that was what Franklin was concerned with. I mean, he knew that he didn't want to be kind of a lonely genius, and he knew that discovery was about teamwork. And Franklin was a great team player when it came to science. The electrical experiments, to some extent, were teamwork, actually. And he did give credit to his fellow team members. And I think he saw the need to build a kind of infrastructure of colleges, universities, even laboratories, and learned societies, learned journals, and so on, so that you could build up a kind of team culture of science in what is now the United States. I think that's what he saw, and he understood that, I think, very early in the 1740s. And I would see that, actually, in many ways, as his great legacy, the fact that the United States has such an excellent research and development base, because that, in a sense, you could argue, is actually the thing that actually America has that other countries don't have necessarily.
The book wraps up around the time that he's doing his work with electricity. Yeah. But it also, I think, points out that a lot of us have this impression that, you know, Benjamin Franklin discovered electricity, period, full stop. He was part of it, but he wasn't all of it.
Well, he wasn't all of it, no, but he was very, very important. Essentially what had happened was that there had been a period of a fairly intense debate and investigation about electricity, starting in sort of really from some work that Newton did, Newton and various colleagues of his, in about 1710, 1720. And there was a lot going on in France, there was a lot going on in Germany in the 1730s and 40s. But the problem was they tended to run into blind alleys and to dead ends, because what would happen is they would investigate phenomena of electricity, the sparks and shocks and flashes and so forth, and they knew how to make a generator and so on. And then they would try and build quite elaborate theories on the basis of these empirical results that they had. And the theories simply weren't up to the job. They were too cumbersome, often they were confused, the language was confused. What Franklin had a great knack for was that not only could he do the physical work of experimentation, he was a very good observer, and also very good at designing apparatus, but he also was very, very good at logically analyzing what he saw. He had a very rigorous, very methodical brain, and so he was able to take confused results and come up with a very simple, elegant hypothesis for explaining them. And that's really important, because obviously in scientific explanation, you really need to get the most simple and economical explanation you can for the data, and that's what he could do, because he had this very sharp, logical brain. His prose is remarkable, actually, for the clarity of it, the fact that it's so easy to follow the steps of the argument.
We meet a number of characters in his life that we don't know much about, but one that really struck me that we really know very little about until now is Mrs. Franklin.
Yes, that's right. It's shameful, really, that Deborah Franklin has been so neglected. Not only neglected, but actually kind of treated with scorn by some biographers who kind of brush her aside. Now, the difficulty is that nobody after Deborah's death actually troubled to collect all her papers or her correspondence. I mean, it's really remarkable in a way that we don't really have belongings of Deborah Franklin, objects that she owned, because there are many characters in the 18th century who are far less significant, actually, where we do have indeed items from their possessions and so forth, and really nobody bothered. So you have to kind of do a bit of lateral thinking. And what I did with Deborah Franklin was I tried to unearth some more material about her family. And what I found was that actually she came from an interesting background herself. Her family were artisans and craftsmen and even engineers in Birmingham in England. Birmingham in England being kind of the cradle of the Industrial Revolution from the English point of view. And so you can see Deborah is actually being part of the same kind of culture of ingenuity that Franklin was part of. They fitted very neatly together. And she also had some great skills of her own. I mean, she was a bookkeeper, she's very good at that. And that was something that women did in England. Women worked as a bookkeeper in a tradesman's firm. It was also not uncommon, if a tradesman died in England, for his business to be taken on by his wife, who she wouldn't necessarily do the physical work herself, she'd hire other people to do it. But that was the kind of thing Deborah Franklin, I think, was capable of. And if, let's say, Benjamin Franklin had passed away, and he did have some quite serious illnesses on one or two occasions, I think she would actually have carried forward the flame, so to speak. But I have tried to do what I can in the book to kind of give her a bit more of a share of the narrative, because I think she has been treated really very badly indeed.
And that, of course, leads to a discussion of his children, which also comes up in the book, which is also something that we don't seem to know much about, maybe because he's so fascinating we never think about, well, did he have children? Did he have a wife? But he did have children, and there were some interesting stories there, one out of wedlock. And another, Frankie, with a very sad story there. Tell us about that.
Well, the story of Frankie is very sad indeed. I mean, Franklin never really said very much about this, about the death of his son Frankie in the 1730s when the boy was really very young. It's something that clearly kind of scarred his soul. I mean, I think there are certain things in Franklin's life that he found very painful to recollect, and this was definitely one of them. He died in a smallpox epidemic. It was a very sad little story, and as I say, very, very little is known about it. There's a picture that survives, although the exact whereabouts of that picture are not entirely clear now. They seem to be in private possession somewhere. So generally, it's something that's been passed over. But it's pretty clear that was kind of a bit of a turning point, I think, in Franklin's life.
He was also an inventor. We know of the Franklin stove and the Franklin fireplace, and they're not the same thing.
Well, that's right. The fireplace was what he originally devised in the early 1740s. It was a cast iron fireplace designed to heat a room efficiently with as minimum use of wood and minimum use of fuel, and to keep as much of the heat in the room as possible. And the reason it was very worthwhile at the time was there had been a succession of very hard winters in Pennsylvania. And the difficulty was, as Philadelphia grew and as the population expanded, so it was becoming harder and harder to find firewood within easy reach of the main centres of settlement, particularly Philadelphia itself. So he wanted to come up with this device which would be more economical and more efficient. In addition to that, the iron and steel industry was really starting to develop in Pennsylvania in a big way at that time. And the people, many of his friends were people working in iron and steel. And the Franklin fireplace was a beautiful example of the iron master's art, because it was made out of these lots of iron plates that were cast individually and with a degree of precision and then screwed together. And that was something which could be done for the first time at that particular point, sort of circa 1740. And so it's very important. It was also the moment at which Franklin started to move into science. He started to leave printing behind and become something close to a full-time scientist. Still took him a few years after that, but that was really kind of a turning point.
As you look back on his youth, we have some idea of what he was like when he was older. Was there was it a straight line going up, or was there a point where something really changed and created the Franklin that we think of today?
Well, he was pretty good at making plans for himself and then sticking to them. I think the trip to London in 1724-6, I think, was very important indeed. I think the move to Philadelphia was very important. And also the fact that Franklin was very good at, if you like, understanding the world around him. He could see the potential of Philadelphia. Now, Philadelphia had huge potential, and Philadelphia was taking over from Boston as really the commercial heart of what is now the United States. And Franklin understood that, even though he's only about 20. He actually has a very interesting passage in his autobiography where he talks about the fact that there were lots of people who were trying to cool down Philadelphia in the economy. There were lots of people who were very pessimistic. They thought everything was going to end in ruin and everything was going to collapse and so on. And Franklin calls them the croakers because he always was confident in what was going on in Philadelphia. And I think that was very important. He had moved to Philadelphia. He understood it had this immense amount of potential, and then he just stuck at it. And again, there you see one of the things that's very important about Franklin was sheer persistence. He just stuck at it year after year until he made a success of his printing business and that enabled him to move on to become a scientist.
What do you suppose his personality was like? Was he a likable person?
Well, I think he would have fits of anger. There's no question he did. That was something people observed in his later life in Paris. He could, I think, be egotistical and a little bit selfish. I mean, certainly his attitude towards his grandson and his attitude towards some other family members was not always as warm as it might be. To a degree of self-centeredness in Franklin, I think, particularly as he grew older, but that's something which often happens to people as they grow older. He was clearly great fun to be with. He wasn't quite as eloquent, I think, as people imagine him to be. I mean, as he said himself, he wasn't very good at public speaking. He was a very good writer, and he was very good in small groups, but he didn't care for public speaking. He had enormous presence. I think when Franklin came into the room, he was the kind of person everybody would notice. I don't think he would necessarily try to dominate the room, but you couldn't miss him. And as soon as you started to hear him talk about the things he knew about, which was a great deal, you would soon see just what a powerful intellect he had.
Well, I think a lot of us sort of think of him as contemporaneous with the other founding fathers, but he was older.
He was much older.
He was the sage.
Absolutely key point. The fact that he was 30 or in some cases 40 years older than the other great heroes of the American Revolutionary period, much older than Washington, much older than John Adams, much older than Thomas Jefferson or Alexander Hamilton. And that meant that he really came from a different era. It's a very important thing to bear in mind that he was actually born when Queen Anne was still on the throne. And when he died in 1790, Napoleon was already 21 and Beethoven was already 21 and the French Revolution had happened. Now that's a huge span of history. The difference between the world of Queen Anne and the world of Robespierre and the French Revolution is really enormous. And Franklin was a man who had his feet in both camps, so to speak. You know, he came out of a kind of 17th century world in some ways, and yet he actually lived to see, as I say, the French Revolution, the Romanticism, all those great movements that paved the way for the 19th century. And that's a huge span of history. And not only that, but he actually understood that it was a huge span of history. He wasn't somebody who, as he got older, thought everything's going to hell in a handbasket, which many of us start to think. He actually was positive and enthusiastic about the future, which is quite hard to do, you know, as you get older, but he certainly did it.
In doing your research, was there something you were looking for that you never could find that you hoped to find?
I think one thing I was disappointed by was that I couldn't quite fix down some of the issues about his education. Now, we know that he went for a year to what was then the grammar school in Boston, became the Boston Latin School. And we know that he went to an academy run by a chap called Mr. Brownell, where they used to learn arithmetic and bookkeeping and so on. But I would like to know a bit more in detail of exactly how he learned to read and so forth, and how exactly he picked up some of the things he did, like, for example, his skill with languages.
What would you say is Benjamin Franklin's legacy?
I think his greatest legacy is American science, actually. Others would say something different. Others would say it was aspects of the Constitution. Others would say it was journalism. Others would say it was his role in the Revolutionary War. Personally, though, I think it's his science, actually. Because before Franklin, there had been American scientists. There were astronomers. There was Cotton Mather himself in Boston, who was interested in science, particularly in astronomy and medicine. There was a guy called John Winthrop at Harvard, who was an astronomer. There were botanists, there were other people. But there was a kind of unfocused quality, a lot of this. What Franklin's great legacy was that he turned science into something rigorous and systematic, a program of research carried out by a team, a kind of collaborative endeavor aimed at getting at truths which were interesting in themselves and would help to produce more scientific learning, but also that were useful as well. That was, to my way of thinking, Franklin's greatest contribution. Others might disagree.
Well, the book is Young Benjamin Franklin. It's fascinating and certainly somebody that we think we know, but maybe there's some things we don't know. We appreciate you being here, Nick Bunker. Thank you.
Thank you. Not everyone cared for what Franklin was up to. In the words of Thomas Penn, the owner of his colony, Franklin was a very uneasy spirit, which was true. The evidence was plain to see in Franklin's hyperactivity. Even when in Paris in his 70s he lingered over breakfast, he was reading, thinking, making plans, and putting them into practice. As we grow older, many of us prefer to live in our memories and to rest on whatever meager laurels we possess, but Franklin did not. He always wanted to do something more, including the creation of America's Republic.
And just as Tom here has written, though the shell may belong to Great Britain, the eagle inside belongs to us.
And just as Tom here has written, we say to hell with Great Britain, the eagle inside belongs to us.